God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And as in the last kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee, and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what the Lord Jesus Christ said. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Controversy, to defend with sound reasoning and great charity the Catholic and Reformed religion. Grant that we may maintain that middle way, not as a compromise for the sake of peace, but as a comprehension for the sake of truth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the first letter to the Corinthians. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. The word of the Lord.
Commit your way to the Lord and put your trust in him.
Commit your way to the Lord and put your trust in him.
Do not fret yourself because of evildoers. Do not be jealous of those who do wrong, for they shall soon wither like the grass, and like the green grass fade away. Put your trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on its riches.
Given me, I have given them, so that they may be one, as we are one, I in them.
what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. Please be seated. Richard Hooker's life and ministry left a legacy of wisdom and truth, of sound reasoning and great charity, a legacy of the written word. As we hold his life and work alongside our reading from 1 Corinthians and its apparent skepticism of human wisdom and lofty words, these questions come to mind. Where do wisdom and reason come from? And where do they lead us? Hooker's time, as our colleague describes it, was one of bitter controversy. Born just before the end of Queen Mary's reign, his entire education and ministry took place within the reign of Queen Elizabeth I. More and more, the theological conflict became less between English reformers and Roman Catholics, and more between the reformers and those who wished to go on reforming, the Puritans primarily. These Puritans, as described by C.S. Lewis, held a theology which set a God of inscrutable will over against the accursed nature of man, with all its arts and sciences, traditions, learning, and merely human virtues. Then there is only one question when looking at human institutions. Is it of God or is it of man? If the former, worship it. If the latter, tear it down. It followed then that the scriptures, the only source of truth, divine truth for the Puritans, are over against these merely human ways of knowing. This competitive view of scripture and reason, revelation and nature, God and humanity, simply would not do for Richard Hooker. From his position as a fellow at Oxford, Hooker was appointed the master of the prestigious Temple Church in London and immediately began engaging in passionate public conflict with Puritans, primarily through preaching and primarily with the minister directly below him at the Temple Church, Walter Travers. They had dueling sermons. It was in such sermons that Hooker uttered such unthinkable teachings as, Roman Catholics will probably be saved. I know, very unthinkable for his time. Hooker grounds this assertion in a belief that we worship and seek a merciful God, ready to make the best of that little which we hold well. That little which we hold well. From the beginning, his approach to theology was grounded in a pastoral awareness of others and of himself. As he further distinguished himself as a cleric of great clarity, capacity, and charity, he was encouraged by friends, family, colleagues to lend his voice to the cause of upholding both the Catholic and Reformed religion. And so he does, composing over the course of several years his first and only book, The Laws of Ecclesiastical Polity, in 8 books. In it, he responds to the most serious criticisms and claims of the Puritans, claims that the church should not do or teach anything specifically not found in Scripture, and that human reason and wisdom have little, if nothing, to offer. He does this while also articulating a positive vision for the church and of Christian faith. It is worth mentioning here that Hooker was only able to fulfill his vocation because of the community of support around him. He was supported financially and emotionally by his spouse, Joan, and her family, with whom the Hookers lived in London. I'm sure I'm not the only one in the room who can identify with this, being supported by your spouse and your loved ones to fulfill your vocation. Amen. We owe as much to Joan as to Richard for the legacy they created. Likewise, as one might imagine, publishers of the time did not expect 8 volumes of theology to fly off the shelves. So Hooker's close friend and colleague Edwin Sandys financed all of the publishing costs up front so that his mind could be shared with the world. It took a village. And now a note for those of us who have from time to time experienced difficulty with Hooker's writing. His characteristic unit, as described by C.S. Lewis, is the long, syntactically Latinized sentence. To demonstrate this, Lewis offers his own Hookerian sentence. The Latin syntax is there for use, not ornament. It enables him, as English syntax would not, to keep many ideas, as it were, floating in the air, limiting, enriching, and guiding one another, but not fully affirmed or denied until at last, with the weight of all that thought behind him, he slowly descends to the matured conclusion. This structure mirrors the movement of his mind. This makes his thoughts difficult to turn into quips or sound bites. Again, Lewis writes, "Indeed, very few of Hooker's beauties can be picked like flowers and taken home. You must enjoy them where they grow, as you enjoy a 20-acre field of ripe wheat." So let's enter that field together. Hooker defines law in this way, a directive rule unto goodness of operation. A directive rule unto goodness of operation. A God-given way to achieve a God-given purpose. For Hooker, law is not merely a code or system of human origin to reward good behavior and punish bad. What Hooker is describing is, in fact, the fabric of the cosmos, keeping all things in relationship and revealing the mind of the Creator at every level. In contemplation of these natural laws, humans have the ability to seek the ultimate source of their desire, God. And all of this is before revelation enters the picture. For Hooker, all humans, by virtue of their creation in the image and likeness of God, as the union of intellect and matter, can participate in natural theology. And the very same God that so graciously gave the gifts of memory, reason, and skill to us offers something more. Revealed truth. That which we would not have been able to discern on our own. The scriptures. And these scriptures, this revealed truth, do not erase the gifts of reason and wisdom. Reason is the key that unlocks the riches of scripture. The riches of God's loving, relational self-offering to us. And so, Puritans, we need not strip away all that is not found in Scripture. We need not denigrate the gifts of reason and wisdom and even lofty words, for their true source is God. Where does wisdom come from? From the source of all life-giving law, God. So what does this wisdom point to? Where does it lead us? For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. For Hooker, all wisdom points to the crucified Christ, the God of all creation incarnate in Jesus, whose power redeems us. This wisdom points to the Christ that Hooker experienced in his real human life as a priest, scholar, husband, father, and friend. While Joan Hooker's name does not appear in the laws, her tender love is clear in Hooker's assertion that the kind of love which is the perfectest ground of wedlock is seldom able to yield any reason of itself. In other words, love has a power beyond reason. Likewise, Hooker's writing on grief and sorrow was surely shaped by his own experience of loss. While the name of his firstborn Richard, who died mere days after his baptism, does not appear in the text of his writings, Hooker's love and grief live in his words. God will have them that shall walk in the light to feel now and then what it is to sit in the shadow of death. Even Hooker knew what it was to sit in the shadow of death. It is this very shadow of death that for Hooker is transformed by what Paul describes as the power of God, Christ and Christ crucified. All of our wisdom and reason points us to the cross and therefore the altar. Here, where we encounter the power of the crucified Christ's body and blood, here, where we offer ourselves, our souls and bodies, to the God of all creation and source of all wisdom, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice. And it is here, according to Hooker, that the words of our reading from 1 Corinthians are made real for us and for the world. They are things wonderful, which he feeleth, great, which he seeth, and unheard of, which he uttereth, whose soul is possessed of this paschal lamb. What no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. It is through this sacrifice, once offered, made present to us in this moment, that we show forth what no eye has seen. It is through our union with Christ and one another that we tell the good news that no ear has heard. It is here that we encounter things that the human heart has not conceived. It is here that we receive and become what God has prepared for those who love him. So come and offer yourselves. Bring all of your wisdom, all of your reason, all of your experiences to this altar where we receive infinitely more than we can ask or imagine, where we receive the source of all wisdom and reason made incarnate. And here, become a people possessed by the Paschal Lamb and go to share where what you have here received. What no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for us who love him. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole stage of Christ's church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word hast taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against thee in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved thee with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of thy Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in
of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him. Have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you.
Okay.
peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with thy spirit.
Brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Because in Jesus Christ our Lord, thou hast received
us as thy sons and daughters. Made us citizens of thy kingdom, and given unto us the Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and that thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that, by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we, and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion, may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice,
Yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not blame our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore let us eat of feast. Alleluia.
Of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, keep you in everlasting life. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, keep you in everlasting life. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, keep you in everlasting life.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God,
we most heartily thank thee for thou hast feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and thus assure us that thy eye of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are your neighbors who is more reverent in the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company
Thank you. Lord.